Today we are going to have a different type of a meeting where we will be discussing a topic which has not been discussed. That is obstetric antiphospholipid syndrome. Our next meeting will be on 1st of August, and the next meeting CME will be on 8th of August. I welcome you all, and I ask Dr. Rajkumar Shah to tell you about the details of the meeting.
Well, good morning, friends. It's a nice Sunday morning, and we are there for another meeting of the AFG. Now the question comes, why another CME? We have so many CMEs going on. Why another CME? Well, as Dr. Urmila suggested, that there are certain topics which require careful consideration. And this one which you selected today is a particular topic which requires quite a good amount of consideration. Most of the topics are confounding, as these conditions are not very commonly encountered. It involves other faculties also. And the hallmark of AFG meetings has been audience participation. And here we have given the audience or all our members an avenue of sort of expressing themselves, their doubts, their queries, so that we can, each and every query can be addressed to make the topic complete as such. The next question is, why antiphospholipid syndrome? Well, this is a unique prothrombotic condition which predisposes to venous thromboembolism, what is called as acquired thrombophilia. And there are many unanswered questions on this topic as to when to investigate, when not to investigate, what tests, et cetera. Besides recurrent pregnancy loss, are there any other implications? So all these questions keep on coming to the mind. And so therefore we require some good amount of discussion on this. Please use the chat box to write your queries pertaining to antiphospholipid syndrome. Please do not enter your MMC registration. This meeting is not MMC accredited. So use the chat box only for writing questions pertaining to antiphospholipid syndrome and not recurrent pregnancy loss, please. So with these words, I hand you over back to Ujwala for continuing the proceedings. Thank you.
Madam, you have to unmute yourself.
Ujwala, unmute yourself.
May I now invite Dr. Agarwal? He is a convener for the meet. He has 50 years of experience clinically, and his special interest is in vaginal hysterectomy. The second convener of the meet is Dr. Mukesh Agarwal. He is an IVF specialist, and he is in practice since 30 years. He is founder and director of Arush IVF and Endoscopic Center at Malad and Mira Road. May I now ask the conveners to introduce the chairpersons?
Good morning. I welcome Dr. Mahesh Sasar. He is practicing from last 3 decades at the Kandivali. He is known for the emergency. Whenever he is there, all emergency or high risk delivery become a low risk delivery. He is famous for the traditional obstetric practice like vaginal delivery, forceps delivery, and vaginal surgery. But nowadays, he is changing to the advanced womanhood, modernization. So he is a combination of the traditional gynecologist and modern gynecologist. Welcome, Dr. Mahesh Sasar.
Good morning, friends. Our next chairperson is Dr. Samir Pradhan. He is a director of Summer Maternity and Nursing Home at Mulund. And also he is an active member of various organizations like FOCSI, MOGS, AFG, SOVSI. And he is a joint secretary for SOVSI Maharashtra chapter. He is a visiting consultant to various hospitals like Godrej Memorial Hospital, Fortis Hospital, Shushrusha Hospital, Hiramungi Hospital, and Jupiter Hospital. His keen interest is in gynec endoscopy, vaginal surgery, and high-risk obstetrics. So I invite Dr. Samir Pradhan. Please take it forward.
Thank you very much, sir, for the kind introduction. Dr. Ashar, sir?
Yes, Samir, can you hear me?
Can you introduce our speaker?
Good morning. Good morning. It's my pride, privilege to introduce our chief speaker today, Dr. Sushant Shinde. Dr. Sushant Shinde is a very famous physician. His academic traditions to his credit are he's done his MBBS from the Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences at Karad. He's done his internal medicine MD at KIIMS, and he was a senior registrar there for a long time. He was a research officer in rheumatology, and he's a EULAR certificate in rheumatology. Today, he's a senior physician practicing at Dadar and Goregaon. He has the Quest Clinics over there. He's a medical educator in the Quest Medical Academy, and he's a trustee at the Ram Vardhayani Health Foundation. May I present Dr. Sushant Shinde, please?
Thank you, sir. So, can I share my screen?
Yes, sir.
So at the outset, I would like to thank AFG and especially Dr. Urmila Sudhakar Madam for this kind invitation. Very good morning to all of you. As has already been introduced, APS or antiphospholipid syndrome, it's not a common condition. In the next 45 minutes that I have, I would like to present an overview of this condition. I'm sure there are going to be a lot of questions. I am expecting, honestly, a lot of questions to come on the therapeutic aspects, because as clinicians, that is what we often require. But there is always a connection between therapy and pathophysiology. So I'll try my best to give the relevant points in pathophysiology, which make it interesting to decide how we are going to treat this. Now, first and foremost, are we dealing with a common condition over here? The answer is absolutely no. There are a lot of patients that people from your branch, obstetrics, are primarily going to see, but by no means is this a common condition. Why is this important for us? Well, because there can be differentials. There can be other reasons why you see patients who can have either similar clinical features, or there can be patients who have these laboratory parameters coming out positive without actually having a disease. That makes it a little difficult. We are dealing with something which might not be very common and which would have differential diagnosis, which we'll have to work up separately. And our treatments are going to be anticoagulation. So I think before I start, I would like to speak forward the philosophy by which we should be addressing this particular concern. I think if we look at rheumatology, which I primarily practice, this is always our concern that do no harm. It is, of course, throughout any branch of clinical medicine or surgery that we practice so. But in rheumatology, we have drugs which are toxic. And at some times, we are more concerned about our drugs than we are concerned about what patient has come to us with. So do no harm will remain the guiding principle if we are going to talk about anything in rheumatology, and especially if we are dealing with something as rare as antiphospholipid syndrome. Now, when we talk about antiphospholipid syndrome, the first question is, of course, what is phospholipid? Now, can I just request the host to spotlight me? I think I can do that. Okay. Speak in between. I'd like to keep my presentation slides also on a lower side. So when we talk about antiphospholipid syndrome, the first question, of course, is what are phospholipids? What are we dealing with over here? We are dealing with antibodies against phospholipid, but phospholipid is the cell membrane. If you look at the cell membrane, almost all the cells that we know of and are of interest to us, they would have phospholipid at the cell level. So if you have a cell membrane made up of phospholipid, how do I end up having an antibody against it? Now, exact mechanisms, we do not know. Why did we develop an antibody against the phospholipid? We do not know. There are possibilities. One possibility, which is always considered in most of our rheumatic conditions, is possibly a past infection. There could have been a past viral infection, which caused the cell to rupture. The components of the cell membrane got exposed to the immune system, and the immune system reacted to it by forming antibodies against it. There could be other possibilities as well. It could be something to do with hormonal changes. It could be some other environmental factors like smoking. So we do not know precisely why did the body of a particular person decide to have antiphospholipid antibody. But that said, are we talking about one common antibody over here? Are we saying that there is a one specific type of antiphospholipid antibody? Unfortunately, the answer to that is no. We have, there are thousands of candidates of what can be antiphospholipid antibodies. But over a period of time, we have able to narrow down and say at least three of them are important for clinical context. we have to understand how we have approached this idea. We have not come with an idea that we know what is happening to this patient. We are guessing. I mean, we, over a period of decades, we have been guessing and trying to narrow down, okay, what possibly of these antiphospholipid antibodies is really damaged. Now, what we know right now is one of the important components of these antibodies is beta-2-glycoprotein. Now, beta-2-glycoprotein, which is a molecule you can see over here, I'm trying to highlight in blue. Beta-2-glycoprotein is actually not a phospholipid. So if I look at this phospholipid membrane, beta-2-glycoprotein is not really a part of the phospholipid membrane. So it's actually wrong to call an antibody, which is anti-beta-2-glycoprotein, as antiphospholipid. So we have to understand what we call as antiphospholipid antibody is actually a sort of misnomer. It's not really an antibody against the phospholipid in all the cases. One of our very important component there is beta-2-glycoprotein. Now this beta-2-glycoprotein, what does it do in my body? The job of beta-2-glycoprotein in our body is two things. One, it is going to take care of homeostasis. That means it is going to take care of the bleeding being controlled or uncontrolled. So it has a role to play in the activation of the coagulation cascade. Second is it has a role in inflammation. Under normal circumstances, I need this beta-2-glycoprotein. In its inactivated form, it is circulating in our body. It's not really attached to the cell membrane. It is circulating in our body. Now, we don't know what is the exact reason, but we do know by now, and it's again a heavily debated topic right now in immunology, that the structure of this beta-2-glycoprotein has changed in patients who have APS, patients who have antiphospholipid syndrome. What we know is from being a circular molecule that it is, we can see this over here that the molecule is circular. Instead of that, the molecule has become what we call J-shaped. I would like to show that quickly in this slide. This is just to show the level of confusion that we have. I'm just trying to annotate on this. I think the annotation has been switched off. I'm sorry. So when we talk about beta-2-glycoprotein, it's supposed to be a circular molecule. What we know is in patients who have APS, the molecule is no longer circular, but has taken the J shape. You can see in these where my cursor is in the top panel, in the middle panel, as well as the third panel, it has become J shape. What we are not sure is what happened first. What happened first in meaning, did it become J shape by its own? And then we developed an antibody against a new structured beta-2-glycoprotein? Or is it that our antibody itself made it to become J-shaped in some other manner? So we are not sure how did we really form the antibody, and did the antibody change the structure of beta-2-glycoprotein, or has something else changed the structure of beta-2-glycoprotein and that has caused the antibody to be formed and attached to this molecule? But once beta-2-glycoprotein has an antibody against it, that antibody is going to activate this beta-2-glycoprotein and it is going to start attaching towards endothelial surfaces. So as you can see in this slide, for some reason, we do not know the reason, we can see on the left side of the slide that the B cells are excess in producing antibodies. Once I have these antiphospholipid antibodies, they're attaching to their targets. One of the targets that we have been able to identify is beta-2-glycoprotein. Now, there are other two antibodies that we all are aware about, or two other tests that we are aware about. One is anticardiolipin. Anticardiolipin also interacts with the beta-2-glycoprotein. And we have lupus anticoagulant, which is also dependent on the activity of beta-2-glycoprotein. We, again, have reached a stage where we can say beta-2-glycoprotein is central to the pathogenesis of APS because it seems to be occurring in all three of them. There is an anti-beta-2-glycoprotein antibody, one. Two, we have anticardiolipin, which is also dependent on, which also has a target as beta-2-glycoprotein. And three, lupus anticoagulant is also dependent on proteins which depend on beta-2-glycoprotein. So all the three tests have something to do with this. How exactly are they being formed? We don't know. But we do know that somehow beta-2-glycoprotein has a central. But once I have antibody against them, what next is going to happen? The next steps can be in three parts. We can see three things which can happen. As we can see on the left side of our marker, of the slide that is up over here, we can see that the inflammatory cells are going to get activated. One important thing that we know is once the antibody and the protein attach, they start activating the complement path. Now here I would like to kind of take a halt and take a step back. Complement pathway activation is something which is one of the steps in both inflammation as well as thrombus formation. But when I think of complement system activation, what other diseases come to mind? So am I dealing with something which is only happening in APS, or is complement activation, once I have an antibody antigen reaction, is the attachment leading to complement activation also happening in some other diseases? Well, the answer is we have other diseases, like there are forms of glomerulonephritis, which we don't deal in rheumatology, which my nephrology colleagues would deal with. But in rheumat, one big disease which we see where complement is activated is lupus, SLE. And as most of us must be aware here, APS and lupus have a strong connection. In fact, antiphospholipid syndrome, as I'll go ahead and we'll speak of this again, can be divided into primary antiphospholipid syndrome, where it is just APS, or it can be divided into secondary antiphospholipid syndrome, which is much more commoner, where you might have other diseases and APS is a part of that other disease. And very often than not, that other disease happens to be SLE. So this complement activation, which we see in APS, might not be a very specific thing happening only in APS. It might be a part of a spectrum that it might be happening in primary APS. It might also be happening in secondary causes of APS like SLE or rheumatoid arthritis or other autoimmune diseases as well. So once the complement system starts getting activated, there is going to be infiltration by other immunologic or inflammatory cells, and we are going to see inflammatory reactions. The target of this inflammatory reaction is very important for us to remember. One of the target is, of course, the inflammatory cells, that is monocytes and neutrophils. We are going to have activation of growth factors. We are going to have netosis, that is neutrophils releasing and trapping and causing extracellular damages. But one important target is going to be the endothelial cell. Once the endothelial cell is involved, we have to understand there is a secondary problem of coagulation cascade getting activated. Once the endothelial cell is damaged, we start seeing activation of glycoprotein 2B3A, which is procoagulant. We also see decrease in the activity of anticoagulation, that is in form of protein C activity of fibrinolysis. Overall, the activity comes. So a combination of inflammation, complement pathway activation, along with damage to the endothelial cells, this is causing a procoagulant state. We have decreased our anticoagulation activity and we have increased our procoagulant activity. Now, there is a model which we have kind of borrowed from probably malignancies, that patients who have antiphospholipid syndrome, they might have antibodies for a long time. So there are some papers which say that probably the first hit of having an antiphospholipid antibody formation, which I showed in the first slide. So if I just go back, what I showed over here, this step might be the first hit because of maybe a past viral infection or maybe some reason which we don't know, this particular person started making antibodies. But these antibodies coming and causing the thrombus formation or coming and causing inflammatory changes elsewhere, this might require a second hit. There might be some other environmental triggers why a patient was doing fine for so many years and all of a sudden the APS features started coming. So there might be two different environmental factors. These are hypothesis state. We don't know these environmental factors. We believe there is something. But it could be viral infections again, or could be some other environmental factor, because of which in the second stage, inflammatory responses and procoagulant state has come in, which means, now that has an implication for us, which means I might have a long stage where the patient has antibodies, but has no clinical features. This will have bearing when I try to treat, that I might get patients who have antiphospholipid antibodies present, but they have absolutely no clinical features. And when I extensively investigate, I do not find evidence of either secondary conditions like SLE or a primary APS causing any inflammatory or prothrombotic state. Now, if we get this idea clear, we have to also understand that for a long time, we have been trying to figure out, is the clinical profile of APS consistent? That means we know that it causes inflammation. We know it causes thrombosis and we understand these pathways. But what is of interest to our discussion today is the third problem, that there is going to be obstetric problems as well. We are going to see a bad obstetric history whenever we are dealing with APS. Now, this for a long time we believed is a result of this procoagulant state. We thought for a long time that, okay, these patients are going to have thrombus formation. And because they have been having thrombus formation, that thrombus is going to cause placental insufficiency. And that perhaps is the reason why we are seeing bad obstetric history. But this was, last decade or two, this has been contested. It has been contested because we found that the biopsies from those placenta where there were miscarriages, they were not showing these clots. We were not seeing really any clots coming up there. There were some cases which were showing clots, but it wasn't a consistent finding. So people started thinking again, and we have these, over here I've just enumerated the reasons why there is a thrombus formation. These are same as what I saw in the last slide, that there is a increased procoagulant activity as well as endothelial disturbances. But over a period of time, we believe that there are also other reasons beyond clot formation which are responsible for fetal loss. Now, one of them is, as we can see on the table on my left side, is the thrombus formation. But there can also be inflammatory changes in the placenta itself. There can be inflammatory changes at the placenta level. There can also be an inhibition of the differentiation of the syncytium and trophoblast. this differentiation that should have occurred, if that has halted, that poorly developed placenta, that poor decidua formation, that perhaps is causing pregnancy loss. And there could be also complement activation at the level of the placenta. I have a diagram which pretty much summarizes what we are expecting is happening at the level of placenta. We thought that there is going to be thrombus formation, that yes, is happening. But we are also finding that the antibodies, anti-beta-2-glycoprotein antibodies, they are reacting with the tropoblast, and they're inhibiting their proliferation. We are also finding that they react with the decidual cell and causing a pro-inflammatory state in this particular cell. Now that begs for a question, if really there is inflammation happening at the level of the placenta, I can understand there was clot formation. If there was clot formation, we should give something against the clot formation. But now if we are saying that there is also inflammation over here, shouldn't we be giving anti-inflammatory cells? I'm sure some of us would be thinking on those lines, shouldn't we be giving anti-inflammatory drugs like maybe steroids or maybe something higher end on that, maybe hydroxychloroquine. Now this is what makes it tricky. We believe that there is inflammation, but this is coming from animal studies. All of this data, the last diagram that I showed you, that is coming from animal studies where animals have been injected with antiphospholipid antibodies in a higher titer, and we have been seeing what changes do we see. But when we try to replicate this in what we see from clinical practice, I would like to highlight it over here. This is a knowledge gap. We have not been able to show that use of anti-immunosuppressant on a routine basis, we have not been able to show that improves the clinical outcome, especially the obstetric clinical outcome in these patients. So this is kind of a knowledge gap we still need to fill in. Why is it that we see inflammatory changes, but we have not been able to show that anti-inflammatory works? Is there some missing link over here? Is it something that we have not understood yet clearly? Probably. And as we understand the disease better, we'll be able to figure out maybe much more targeted therapy. But today, we have not been able to show that a particular anti-inflammatory can stop this inflammation and therefore give us a better outcome. It still remains that antiplatelets and anticoagulant gives us a better result than giving anti-inflammatory. So this is something worth remembering as we go ahead in our discussion. Now, if you understand that we are dealing with patients coming with inflammatory changes, we are dealing with patients coming with thrombotic changes, and we are dealing with patients coming with obstetric histories, as well as probably now we have introduced the possibility that complement activation and immune-mediated SLE and other features might be around the corner. We are looking at a mixed bag over here. We are not really dealing with someone who has only one problem of bad obstetric history. The patient, when she comes to you, she has that problem, but there might be other things in the past. Still worse, there might be things left in our future which we have not seen, and we need to act for that as we go ahead. So this is the range of what all can happen to patients when they have antiphospholipid antibodies. We can see inflammatory changes, we can see thrombosis, we can see pregnancy complication, and a new thing which I had not highlighted till now is vasculopathy. We are now realizing that these patients can also have small vessel disease. This might not be completely relevant because, again, as I've said, this is a rare condition. So we might not see it as frequently when I see patients with bad obstetric history. But when I see patients coming with thrombotic complications of APS, this becomes really important because some of them, they don't have clots, but they have the small vessel getting damaged because of the endothelial damage, and they come to us with nephropathy. So we do see patients who come with an overlap that they have thrombotic complications and renal failure. And that's where this idea of vasculopathy or small vessel damage becomes important. Now, with that background, how do we diagnose? We have so many conditions, we have so many things which are going around over here. So we are all aware of this criteria, the Sapporo criteria, the 2006 revision of it. The Sapporo criteria, before I go ahead and kind of read the slide literally, I would like to highlight. The Sapporo criteria was not designed for clinical practice. Again, something we need to remember. It was designed for trials. It was designed so that these people could be standardized and included in trials. Over a period of time, we found that it works in our clinical practice, but we still need to remember there can be things beyond the criteria. There can be patients who do not fit into this criteria and still have APS, and that is going to be an even more grayer zone than what we are right now. So what are the two things we look out for? One is we look out for vascular thrombosis. As the slide clearly says, we need to look out for vascular thrombosis, which is arterial, venous, or small vessel. Now, here, something which, I would like to kind of take back to physiology over here, maybe. I would like to kind of write this down very clearly so that we are all very clear on this. When I talk about an arterial clot, in my mind as a physician, I'm dealing with platelet-rich clot. There is, of course, activation of coagulation cascade, but I'm dealing with a platelet-rich clot when I talk about an arterial clot. What are my examples of an arterial clot? Kahan kahan ki artery ki baat ho rahi hai? We are talking about something like stroke, cerebrovascular accident. We are talking about something like myocardial infarction or maybe a patient having other forms of coronary artery disease. There can be other unusual sites of arteries getting blocked, like we might have mesenteric arteries getting blocked. Rarely you might get some other arteries getting blocked, like you might have sometimes the renal artery or some other arteries getting blocked. But mostly what I'm afraid of is stroke. So that means if a female in front of you who has antiphospholipid syndrome or the antibodies positive, she is to ask you a question, what risk am I really dealing with? What are we really afraid of? It is this risk that I'm really afraid of, that she has a risk of developing a CVA, that is stroke, maybe now, maybe in her future. But we also are talking about venous clots, and we need to understand venous clots behave differently. We all remember the Virchow's triad of our pathology days, where we said that the triad has endothelial dysfunction, stasis, and procoagulant state. So venous is that stasis, DVT. These are patients who don't have a platelet-rich clot. They have just an activation of coagulation cascade. This has applications when I treat. I hear my anticoagulant will work well in a venous clot. Here, I will have to add an antiplatelet because the kind of pathophysiology working is different in the arteries, it's different in a venous system. We remember the venous system can have stasis. I remember it that way. Arterial system is a high pressure zone. It doesn't have stasis. It will have endothelial injury and platelets will get activated. So they will require antiplatelet. Venous system will have venous stasis, like a patient who has developed DVT postoperatively, like a person who is obese and has a sedentary lifestyle, like a person who is maybe post-pregnancy developed DVT, like someone who has post-operatively, as I've said, orthopedic surgery or obstetric surgery has developed DVT. So that kind of a clot is a venous clot. So when we talk about venous clot, what is my example? My prime example in venous clot is going to be DVT. And what I'm afraid of is this DVT will get dislodged and I might end up with pulmonary embolism. So this is the kind of risk profile I'm dealing with. Sometimes I might have rarer conditions of venous clot like cortical venous thrombosis. Again, stroke is arterial here, but cortical venous thrombosis rare, but is possible. There is an added implications, I believe, for obstetricians because venous clots are also increased when we use oral contraceptive pills. So we have to be careful in patients who have antiphospholipid syndrome. When we advise contraception, it's better to avoid using oral contraceptive pills as a modality of contraception for these class of patients. So arterial clot, venous clot, these two, and of course, small vessel disease, that is microangiopathies in form of patients developing renal involvement or sometimes even cerebral. There is a lot of interest happening over here in rheumatology circles. We are interested in this brain. There are patients who don't really have clots. They don't really have any, do an MR angio, don't see a clot. But the patient has been developing recurrent migraine, has been developing a decrease in the cognitive function. So we are possibly now looking at a stage where APS does not only cause clot, but the vessel itself could be damaged without having a clot inside, right? So we are heading towards that possible understanding of, APS. So one big area is, of course, vascular thrombosis. There are a lot of patients who will have vascular thrombosis and will never have obstetric history. They could be men, of course. We can have men coming with APS and the ratio is roughly 8:2. So for every 10 patients, at least two of them are going to be men and they can come with vascular presentations, thrombotic APS as I would call them, and not have any obstetric complications. Of course, I could have women in them also who have only thrombotic APS and not have any obstetric complications. When we are evaluating, these patients meet you in your practice, we will have to go back in the history and ask them for any history of such clot, because if they had that, it will have therapeutic implications. My treatment will be different for a pregnant lady who in the past had thrombotic APS. So this is something we need to watch out for in the history. Now, if someone has thrombotic APS, there is also one more term. I'll just introduce the term. I wouldn't go into the details because it's beyond the topic for today, known as catastrophic APS. Catastrophic APS is a dangerous condition. It's a medical emergency. Thankfully rare, but in SLE and associated autoimmune diseases, we do see it. Catastrophic APS means simultaneously, within a span of 2 weeks, patient has more than 3 organs getting thrombosis. So patient might come with stroke, might come with MI, might come with DVT altogether. So that is a catastrophic APS. Survivals are really low and more than 50% would succumb to it. And those patients really require IVIG and higher end of immunosuppression. In fact, the role of immunosuppression has only been defined in that one subset. I'm saying this because the question will come back again. Can we use immunosuppression? So till now, the role of immunosuppression in APS has not been even shown in a regular APS. It has been shown in APS who has catastrophic APS, which means has three organs getting involved simultaneously, because there we believe inflammation and thrombosis are playing together. That inflammation is strong enough to require anti-inflammatory. But a patient who has just plain APS without having a catastrophic APS, maybe just stroke, maybe one stroke, one DVT, we don't really give them anti-inflammatory always, right? Let's proceed to the next one. The next one is the kind of patient that will present to obstetric practice, where the patient would have any one of these three, that the patient would have three or more sequential abortions before the period of 10 weeks of gestation, or the person could have an unexplained fetal death of a morphologically normal fetus after 10 weeks of gestation, or there could be an early birth before 34th week of a morphologically normal fetus because of either eclampsia, severe preeclampsia, or a confirmed placental failure. Now, I wouldn't be going into the definitions of this because it isn't really my field. So I would leave it at this, that this is what I know. I would, in my practice, rely on someone from your field to tell me that this has happened. And then I would go ahead and evaluate the patient. But the criteria has been very clear. Three or more abortions before 10 weeks. Any one death after 10 weeks, which you feel is a, we have no other clause to explain it. And early birth with a maternal complication of eclampsia, preeclampsia, or confirmed placental failure. In these circumstances, so if someone is to ask me, when should I test a patient? These would be the indications to test a patient, unless you have tested for any other reason. These would be the obstetric indications to test a lady for APS. Should I do it in the first pregnancy? Unless there is a past history of thrombosis, there is no sense to test a lady on the first visit, first pregnancy to test her. Doesn't make sense because, as I've said, the antibody could come out positive. It's a rare thing and it is not necessary that antibody is equal to the disease. So we do not need to test if this has not happened, if these conditions are not met. Now, are there other complications that we are expecting in obstetric practice? I think yes, we all know this, that even if I say APS is not common, APS definitely is one of the common causes of recurrent abortions. And in a patient who is antiphospholipid and having antiphospholipid syndrome, 52% abortion cases are that we see, about 52% is the abortion rate in a patient who is antiphospholipid antibody positive. Now, what would increase this risk? So let's say you have a patient who comes to you who has antiphospholipid antibody positivity. You have diagnosed the patient as having APS. What would increase the chance that this patient is going to have a poorer outcome despite your therapy? Now, despite you treating well, what would keep the patient what will make you think that this is even a high risk? She might not make the next pregnancy as well. Biggest risk factor is the past history of pregnancy loss. If she is antibody positive and has lost a pregnancy in the past, the risk is high. Second is the type of antibody positivity. Now, we have said that there are three antibodies. I'll talk about those antibodies again now. But we have said there are three things we are testing for: lupus anticoagulant, beta-2 glycoprotein antibody, and anti-cardiolipin antibody. If all three are positive, that patient is the highest risk. Very often, we don't get all three positive. We get one of them positive. But if you get all three of them positive, if you get all the antiphospholipid antibody positivity, triple positive patient, we might call him, that triple APS positive patient would be at a higher risk of having poor obstetric history. Similarly, within the antibodies, now this is a little, you know, depends on who has done the study, I guess, because we have a lot of conflicting data here. So I'll just read out what is consensus. We believe that lupus anticoagulant positivity increases the risk. Similarly, positivity for beta-2 glycoprotein antibody independently also increases the risk. So if I have any one antibody positive and someone is to say, okay, I have lupus anticoagulant, beta-2 glycoprotein, anti-cardiolipin, ek batao, isme se ek positive aayega to risk badhega, wo kaun sa hai? My answer would be lupus anticoagulant. It was the oldest that we had identified, and it still continues to confer a higher risk, probably because it is working on, you know, beyond beta-2 glycoprotein. It works on beta-2 glycoprotein dependent proteins, but it is also working on other parameters. It is more of a heterogeneous marker rather than one specific marker. Somehow, it is the one which has the highest risk of, out of all of three, LAC positivity has the highest risk of bad obstetric history. Of course, worst is a patient having three, but if only one antibody positive, I will say it is lupus anticoagulant positivity, which will put the highest risk. Similarly, if someone has anti-cardiolipin IgG subtype, that patient, now this is more like a person who is before pregnancy is going to ask me a question, what is my risk? If, you know, before pregnancy, if a lady asks me, what is my risk if I have IgG ACL positive, I'll say your risk of obstetric complication is higher than the thrombotic complication. That doesn't change much in my practice really, but that's what is known. And if someone is ACL positive, that increases the risk of preeclampsia and also increases the risk of placental insufficiency. So these are some things which we have been able to deduce over a period of time. Most of it has come from observational studies. So there are biases in what we have observed, and the amount of risk is variable. Some people put the risk in somewhere close to 20-30, some put the risk at 80-90. So the variability is huge in what kind of risk are we really looking at. As I've said, thrombosis and pregnancy-related complications, these have been developed. The Sapporo criteria was developed for a particular trial basis. It was developed so that we can enroll people in trial. It was never developed for clinical practice. So there can be people who do not meet the criteria and still have APA. So these are the things that we watch out for, more so when the patient comes to us with thrombotic complications. Livedo reticularis, which is the red colored rash that comes usually on the thighs. Patients can have valvular lesions. Very commonly what we look for in patients who have SLE, Lippmann sac endocarditis is a common thing we see with SLE. Thrombocytopenia, something we need to be aware of. It's very interesting. We are talking of someone who will develop clots, but at the same time will have low platelets because of destruction of platelets. Remember, the phospholipid is on the platelet as well. So the patient can have destruction of platelet as well as anemia. So patients can have Coombs test positive anemia and destruction of platelet and simultaneously have clot. This can be a difficult situation to manage because if you don't want to anticoagulate, don't want to give antiplatelet because there is a thrombocytopenia, but on the other side, there is clot formation happening somewhere else. So presence of thrombocytopenia makes your management really tough. One additional thing I would say here is thrombocytopenia, before we conclude it is because of disease, we have to remember that our treatment is heparin. Heparin also can cause heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. So it's a good idea that before we label this patient as having disease-induced thrombocytopenia, we rule out that there isn't a drug associated. That means before we start heparin, would be a good idea to look at platelets. After we start heparin, 2 weeks later, good idea to look at platelets so that at least you're sure aage jaake thrombocytopenia hua, so it wasn't your drug induced, it was a disease related factor. So yes, thrombocytopenia, complicated situation to handle. I have already spoken about cortical venous thrombosis, but similarly patients can have superficial vein thrombosis. Nephropathy, yes. Good interest is coming in this last four from neurology and rheumatology overlap. We see this happening. Patients might present with recurrent migraine, with chorea, with epilepsy, with transverse myelitis like pictures. And these patients might not really show us clots. They might not have a big artery getting blocked. They might have small vessel diseases and white matter changes presenting with these neurologic features. And of course, SLE is possible. We always have to think in terms of SLE. Quite honestly, I am expecting questions on ANA positivity by the time the question and answer session starts. So I'll leave ANA out of the story for now, but I'm sure there will be questions, so I'll take it up over there. But SLE is something around the corner. We have to watch out and always ask for questions of SLE whenever I'm dealing with APAs, strongest association. So these are the antibodies. These are any one of this is what I need to show positive. Either I need to show that the lupus anticoagulant is present, or I need to show an antibody to cardiolipin or an antibody to beta-2-glycoprotein. Things that I would like to highlight over here in this, we all know this. So what are the things that we should not forget? One, these antibodies can come falsely positive if the patient is already on anticoagulation. So especially LSA, we should not test it if the patient is already known to be on anticoagulation. We should test it before it. Or if you have to test it afterwards, then we need to be sure that the titers are really high and that we have other corroborative evidence. Then we shouldn't say that, okay, only antibody positivity makes it APS. We should have other evidence in form of either bad obstetric history or thrombosis, which is correlating with APS. This can be really tricky because there are patients where we just can't stop the anticoagulation. So I have one patient right now, not obstetric, but developed MI, and at the age of 26, developed an MI. Wasn't evaluated at that time. Why did he develop an MI? And subsequently, by the age of 32, has mesenteric ischemia. Now we are thinking, are ye kahin do clots ho gaye, kahin APS to nahi hai. But the problem is, the moment he developed mesenteric ischemia, we had to give him anticoagulation. Now he's on anticoagulation. I can't test him for these antibodies. So this can be a real dilemma in patients. So when we are testing for these antibodies, one thing we should be sure is the patient is not on any anticoagulation drug. Antiplatelet is okay. Aspirin is okay. Anticoagulation is what is not okay. We shouldn't test this when the patient is on anticoagulation. Similarly, other thing that we need to be aware when we are testing is we can get false positive results. So always two tests are required. Before we tell a patient that you are having a rare disease where probably I might want to anticoagulate you for the rest of your life, this is a young individual. So we need to be very sure of our diagnosis. A false positive test might take the story to the wrong direction and the wrong end. Our drugs are harmful. So we have to be very careful before we start them. Definitely we need two tests separated by at least 12 weeks. So two tests are required. Any one of them that you get positive, repeat it after 12 weeks so that we are able to confirm that the patient really has antiphospholipid syndrome or at least the antibody positivity. Third thing of importance over here are the cutoffs. Now, these are a matter of debate. Various guidelines. So the slide that I'm showing you, that is talking about the ACR guidelines, the American College of Rheumatology, which is primarily what we would follow in India. But that's not necessarily true everywhere. This cutoff of 40 units in both of them is something that is debated, especially for anticardiolipin antibody. So an ideal thing is to have a 99 percentile and above. That means I am able to show that of all the values that I get in this particular setting or in this particular lab, my value is more than the 99 percentile of what comes in this particular area that I'm practicing. That is difficult to do. So what I can do at the least is maybe use a good lab, because if my lab is dubious, again, good part for us is we are all, I'm assuming we are all practicing in Mumbai here in this group. So we might not face that problem, but we do get patients coming from outside Mumbai and from places in the interiors of the country where labs are a big concern. So unless we have a good quality lab here, we cannot just follow a cutoff which anybody has put out randomly. Even the international bodies have not been able to reach a consensus. Because these antibodies can be present in normal individuals, drawing a cutoff, we have to be sure that we are talking about someone really higher, and just a borderline positive might not make a lot of sense. So always good to repeat and always good to do from a good lab. Now, these are the antibodies. Once I have any one of these antibody and any one of the criteria, either obstetric or vascular, I can make a diagnosis of antiphospholipid syndrome. Now, at this point, I would like to, before I go towards the guidelines, I would like to halt and say, this is where I would now want to talk about the therapy. I hope I have some time. Can I take around 5-10 minutes? I think I will reach 11:15.
Sushant, you are the guest. You can go ahead easily. No problem.
Okay. Thank you, sir. So I would like to divide the treatment. Now, what I've tried to do is try to keep in mind how, I'm just imagining, of course, how a patient might reach you as practitioners, and what should be the concerns that we should have before pregnancy, during pregnancy, after pregnancy. So I'm trying to divide my treatment chart that way. So this is how I would, this is what I feel we can do if we are dealing with patients and those patients are coming to us with a diagnosis of APA. So now we are not dealing with someone whose diagnosis is not confirmed. We are dealing with someone whose diagnosis is confirmed. We are sure that this is APS. Now with APS, we also have to think in terms, are we dealing with primary APS? That means there is only APS, or are we dealing with secondary APS? When I talk about secondary APS, I'm thinking in terms of SLE. The other question that should concern you is, are we dealing whether primary or secondary? Are we dealing only with thrombotic APS, or are we dealing with obstetric APS, or both? It could be both as well. So we need to be sure of these parameters before we start proceeding any further. Now, before conception, what do I need to know before conception? So if the patient has already lost a child in the past and has come to you, and the advice is, or the decision that you need to take is, when and how should she plan pregnancy? The first question is, of course, investigations. And in investigations, to look for the previous things, I think following investigations might make sense. Of course, confirm the antiphospholipid antibodies. Confirm them. We have seen which antibodies to look for. I would over here say, let's do an ANA. ANA, I again would highlight, ANA anti-nuclear antibody should be done by immunofluorescent assay. All labs in Mumbai can do that. If we don't specify, they'll do an ELISA. ELISA is inferior. So if we do an anti-nuclear antibody, we should ask for an immunofluorescent assay. If ANA comes out positive, then ask for an anti-dsDNA, which is a test for, again, lupus, and ask for serum complement levels. When I ask for serum complement levels, I ask for two things. I ask for complement level C3 and C4. I would again highlight, this is only if ANA is positive. If ANA is negative, there is no sense me going ahead and investigating this part. So if the ANA is positive, go ahead and test for these. Of course, at this point, I would want to look at the baseline of the patient's CBC. I would like to look for the patient's ESR. I would want to look for the patient's CRP. All of these are, now both of these are for the markers of inflammation. I would want to look for the creatinine level, because if I'm going to give heparin or low molecular weight heparin, I need to know the level, and so on and so forth. If there is anything else relevant for that patient, I might do that. But these are the tests I will do with APS in my mind, that these are the investigations I need. If the patient has all of these which show that there is only primary APS, I'm only dealing with the primary APS, and in primary APS, now there are two possibilities. Either the patient has thrombotic or the patient has only obstructive, right? Dono cheez ho sakta hai ki either past me he has had thrombotic, or in the past he has had obstructive only, or she has had, sorry, obstructive only. If she has a thrombotic history, this patient, before we start on therapy, that means before you start on therapy, should already be on two things. Aspirin, that is low dose aspirin, I should rather say LDA, low dose aspirin, and therapeutic dose of low molecular weight heparin. If someone already had a clot, the patient should be on both of these, right? Of course, with the caveat that aspirin would be required only if there is a arterial clot. I would give both of them if there is an arterial clot. I will give only heparin if there is a venous clot. That will be, I would rather leave it to the hematologist or the physician to start it, but this should be started before even the conception is planned, right? So there is no excuse over here. And what I would like to highlight over here is the dose of heparin here is therapeutic dose. I'm going to give a higher dose that of low molecular heparin, and that higher dose would mean I'm giving something like 1 mg/kg twice a day. That is the dose of heparin that I'm going to give. So if we take an example, let's say you have a 60 kg person, you are going to give 60 milligram per day twice a day. That means 0.6 ka jo injection aata hai clexane, you're going to give it twice a day. That's a dose that would be given if the patient had a clot. Remember, we are talking of someone who already had a clot in place. But if someone has no history of clot, that is more likely the patient you're going to see. This is more likely the patient you're going to see who never had a clot in the past. If the lady never had a clot, there is no reason that she is on therapeutic dose of low molecular weight heparin. The only thing that we need to give to such a lady is low dose aspirin. Before pregnancy, what I would start is just low dose aspirin. There is no need to start her on everything else at this point of time. The next case would be, instead of primary, what if it is secondary? What if it is a secondary APS? And when I talk about secondary APS, I'm talking about SLE. That means she is a known case of SLE. Now, I'm not dealing with someone who has just bad obstetric history. I'm talking about a patient who has SLE, confirmed, diagnosed by someone, and she's on therapy. Such a lady would be already on drugs like glucocorticoids. So she'll be on steroids. She would be on hydroxychloroquine, and she might be on something else. And that something else, which is safe, which is relatively safe, I might say, is azathioprine. Other drugs like mycophenolate, cyclophosphamide, methotrexate, they're all contraindicated. We just won't go ahead with the pregnancy. What we might go ahead with pregnancy with is glucocorticoids and hydroxychloroquine plus minus azathioprine. I would strongly say at this point, if the lady is having lupus, it would make it will make a case for the two departments, the rheumatology and obstetric department, to discuss out the case regarding the pros and cons of that particular lady. SLE will be aggravated during pregnancy and post-pregnancy in patients who are uncontrolled before pregnancy. It might have not just a poor obstetric outcome, it might have a poor outcome for the lady itself. Her other organs, especially pulmonary hypertension, renal functions, everything will have to be looked into. So secondary APS might just be someone we do not go ahead with pregnancy unless it's an absolute clearance and the risk is all understood by the rheumatology department, and the patient has clearly a clear idea of what are we heading into. Right? So secondary APS might not be just a very good idea to start therapy, maybe just obstetric OPD. That patient needs to be evaluated. The next possibility is we are dealing with someone who has come to us during pregnancy. So we are dealing with the months of pregnancy now. If this is during the time of pregnancy, then what should I do? Well, again, the question is same. If I'm dealing with primary APS, now I'll stick to primary APS only. If I'm dealing with primary APS, my treatment that has been approved as of now is to start with low dose aspirin. When I talk about low dose aspirin, we are talking in Indian context of 75 to 150 milligram per day of aspirin, and we are talking about a prophylactic dose of low molecular weight heparin. So if we are dealing with primary APS during pregnancy, no role of therapeutic. Remember, here we gave a very high dose, we gave a twice a day dose, There was no sense of giving that kind of a dose for a patient who is having primary APS and no other thrombotic complication. There is nothing in the past. We are just dealing with a pregnant lady who has lost a child in the past and has APS antibody, antiphospholipid antibody positive. We give her a prophylactic dose. And this dose very often is 40 milligram or the 0.4 wala jo dose aata hai, subcutaneous once a day. So that's the dose I'm going to use in the pregnant state. So these are the doses I would use during pregnancy for primary APS. What about hydroxychloroquine? Should I give hydroxychloroquine or not? Highly debatable. This is this is an area where the science is not clear. What I know for sure is if she had other indications for taking hydroxychloroquine, that means she has lupus. No doubt, she has to be on hydroxychloroquine. In lupus, I would give HCQ for the rest of her life. I will not stop it, pregnancy or lactation or kuch bhi ho. I'm not going to stop HCQs. That's the one thing, unless she has an ophthalmic toxicity, which is rare, I'm not going to stop hydroxychloroquine. That's the only thing which we know is protecting her against relapses. So I will not stop hydroxychloroquine if she's lupus. But if she's not lupus, the 2020 guidelines of ACR have said that it is conditional and it is left to the treating team to decide whether they want to start hydroxychloroquine or not. So they have not said do not give it, but they have not said that the evidence is strong. So ACR guidelines, American College of Rheumatology, 2020 guidelines, that's the last one. They're dealing with pregnancy, their guidelines to talk about pregnancy and related rheumatic issues, they have said that hydroxychloroquine can be used at the discretion of the treating physician. So I would say in Indian context, it does make a case. I would very often add hydroxychloroquine to this lady in a dose of 200 milligram per day. Right, 200 milligram per day is the dose of hydroxychloroquine I'll add. At this stage, of course, we need to watch out. And that's something I don't do. So I won't talk of experience. I'm just talking about what is written, that we need to watch out for the complications of preeclampsia. We need to watch out for the complications of decreased fetal activity. But I think I'm not the best person to speak on that. So I just say the monitoring that you guys do, and you should continue doing it as you would judge better than me. Right. The question is, what after delivery? Postpartum, do we stop the drug? Do we change the drug? Remember, here I have not asked any change in drug. This continues right through the point of delivery. Maybe at the time of delivery, if you are worried about the blood loss, you might want to stop. That might be just a few days of stop that you want to do. But really, there is no indication from the medicine perspective of the story to stop the drug. There is no indication to stop the drug. And postpartum. Now, this is a tricky area. Postpartum, I would divide it into two parts. Though the book doesn't say that, the articles don't divide it that way, but that's how I would look at it. That first 6 to 12 weeks, the lady has a risk of thrombus formation, even if she did not have thrombus in the past. So first 6 to 12 weeks, definitely the person should be, this particular lady of obstetric APS, also should be on low dose of heparin. So that's very clear. This is something which all the guidelines have endorsed, that first 6 to 12 weeks after postpartum, you continue the low dose of low molecular weight heparin. You continue it, right? The question is, if she had thrombotic episode in the past, then you can't keep on continuing an injection for long. You will have to shift over to warfarin. And warfarin can be given with lactation. Usually, I would want to shift somewhere around completion of 1 month. So around 1.5 months, I would convert to warfarin. And the duration of warfarin, ideally, if she had any thrombus in the past, would be lifelong. Now, this is something which we don't very often see happening. These are young people. The average age of APS is 35 years. So I don't expect a 35-year-old lady to really follow my advice and say that I'm going to take it lifelong. But what we insist is, even if you can't take it lifelong, take it at least for 2 to 3 years. Your overall risk of thrombotic episodes is highest in this period. So at least take it for 2 to 3 years. The guidelines are definitely saying lifelong, but even the guideline makers understand that it's not practical that we tell someone to take it lifelong and someone really does it. It's not easy. So it should be preferably given for 2 to 3 years. Warfarin has a new contender, the direct acting oral anticoagulants that we have, dabigatran, rivaroxaban, the newer ones which have come up. I will just leave it at one line. I know the use has already started, but no guideline has endorsed it yet. We do not have enough evidence. In a CME, I should be talking only about the evidence that we have. We do not have enough evidence to say that direct acting oral anticoagulants, DOAC, they do not show same efficacy. I should not say efficacy, so safety as warfarin in case of APS. So as of now, the use of it is subjective. The guidelines have not really accepted that they should be used continuously. I would want to end my talk with just summarizing the 2020 guidelines, that if you have an obstetric APS, go for low-dose aspirin with prophylactic dose of low molecular heparin for up to 6 to 12 weeks after pregnancy, continue till that point. If you have thrombotic APS, then of course the lady should be on low-dose aspirin plus therapeutic low molecular heparin throughout pregnancy. Throughout pregnancy, she should be on therapeutic dose. If in the past she has was started, before pregnancy, agar humne shuru kar diya tha, so she continues on that high dose throughout the pregnancy period. If she has only APS positivity, now this is interesting, I didn't cover this, but if the patient has only antiphospholipid antibody positive, but she doesn't fit into the other things, she has not really fit into the obstetric criteria of having more than 3 pregnancy loss before 10 weeks and so on and so forth, then what do I do? Then I don't need to start heparin. Don't start heparin. Start only aspirin, and that too as a prevention for preeclampsia, not really changing the obstetric outcomes. So if she has not fulfilled the obstetric clinical criteria, but has antiphospholipid antibody positive, then start only low-dose aspirin. Low molecular heparin has not been recommended. In fact, it has been recommended against by the ACR. They say, do not use it. The harm is more than any benefit that you might get out of using only seropositive patients, if I call them, don't use it. As I said, we can use it if the patient, hydroxychloroquine can be added if the patient has primary APS. But again, only because an antibody is positive, no. You need to have a diagnosis of APS, obstetric ho ya thrombotic ho, primary ho ya secondary ho, APS ka diagnosis ho gaya, matlab antibody bhi hai aur clinical criteria bhi hai, then use hydroxychloroquine. Just for antibody positive, give only aspirin, do not give hydroxychloroquine. And if you have refractory APS, obstetric APS, that means despite your therapy, the patient lost a child and the next pregnancy has come, what do I do then? Should I use steroids? Should I use IVIG? Should I use some other immunosuppressant? Hydroxychloroquine included. The answer is, as of now, hydroxychloroquine I might still give, but IVIG or higher dose of heparin or steroids or rituximab or other drugs, which we have used in catastrophic APS, except that there is no role shown anywhere. So I would just say at this point, it doesn't fall into the the recommendations to use it. In fact, they have been recommended against. They have used the word do not. They have not said you can or cannot, we don't know. They have said do not use it because there is risk and we do not have enough benefit. So I just go back and conclude with this thing that at all points we want to do no harm. I hope this helped and made sense. I tried to cover as much as I could, but over to the organizers. Thank you so much.
Hello.
Yes.
Hello.
I think that was a yes. Samir, go ahead.
Yeah, sir, go ahead, sir.
No, you go ahead. Go ahead.
Yeah, Dr. Sushant Shinde, sir, an excellent presentation right from the basic to all practical tips. I think most of the questions which were forwarded to you, you have covered. But for the sake of audience, we will ask the questions because then everybody will be aware of it and we can go for revision. I have one question. You said the dose of Ecosprin should be 75 or 150. That is a low dose Ecosprin, right? But for preeclampsia prevention, as per the Aspray trial, we always have to give 150 nowadays. And that is, so if it is a ACL positive, then we always go give the dose of 150. And if it is not ACL positive, we can give 75. Is it the correct thing?
So there are not trials in anything, any of the, so the idea of low dose aspirin came from cardiology. Right, in cardiology also, we don't have trials to really compare 75 versus 150. So I think what we judge that is on the basis of history of bleeding. I'm borrowing this from how we use it in medicine. In medicine, yeah, we use these doses based on what is the risk of GI toxicity or bleeding that a patient might have. For example, in CKD patients or patients of gastric ulcers, we use 75. That's how we decide to dose. So efficacy mein kitna difference hai, I don't think I have enough data to say. Since in obstetrics, we are dealing with relatively younger patients, I think 150 should not be a problem. We can use 150. Yeah. And antiphospholipid positivity or not, I don't think that should change it. I don't know what the obstetric guidelines say about it. but I'm saying the use of therapeutic efficacy of it, 75 versus 150, has
so because never been... your thing mentioned that if that is only ACL is positive, there is a higher risk of IUGR and preeclampsia.
Yes.
So we are trying to extrapolate that, and then the dose of aspirin will be more.
I think 150 makes sense for all patients since we are not dealing with high risk of gastritis, because the real reason to use 75 is to prevent the risk of gastritis, which a lot of patients who are, these drugs come from cardiology. So there we had the concern that the low dose was introduced in cardiology where the concern was gastritis. So 75 was tested. So I think since we don't have that risk, giving the maximum benefit to the patient, I feel 150 should be fine for all patients.
And can you give us the therapeutic dose of the normal unfractionated heparin? Because sometimes our patient don't offer the low molecular weight heparin.
I think it's in units. I'll have to check. I think it's, I'll have to check. It's per kg. I don't remember it off the top of my head.
Do we have to monitor the platelet count or something they say anti-activated factor 10A when patient is on low molecular weight heparin, or we can just blindly give throughout pregnancy?
So before we start using, I'll just stop sharing the slide. Before we start using heparin, it is a good idea to do a complete blood count. And apart from complete blood count, to look for platelets. So there is no other monitoring required when you start low molecular weight heparin. Low molecular weight heparin, the biggest advantage, in fact, three advantages of low molecular weight heparin over heparin. One is that it is subcutaneous versus an IV infusion in case of heparin. Second is low molecular weight heparin does not require any monitoring. The CBC is only done once, 2 weeks after you started, for a rare adverse effect of heparin-induced thrombocytopenia. But apart from that, you don't require any other test of PT, APTT, INR. Nothing is required when you do low molecular weight heparin. In front of that, if I'm giving unfractionated heparin, the IV dose infusion, then I have to look for APTT and I have to keep on looking at the APTT target, whether it has been met, and that monitoring is required. So in the last 10 years, at least in medicine perspective, I have not used low unfractionated heparin at all. So we have completely shifted to low molecular weight heparin. And the third advantage is the availability. Patients who are on heparin, the bioavailability of the drug can be unpredictable, can be different from patient to patient. That is much more static when I use low molecular heparin, and it is not even weight based. So I don't need to monitor the patient's weight and then decide the dose. There is a fixed dose that goes to everyone by and far. So at least in the prophylactic dose, that's 0.4. So I don't need to worry about the bioavailability or the weight of the patient. So these are the advantages we have with low molecular
heparin. And how do you choose the low molecular weight heparin, enoxaparin or deltaparin, or no difference?
So practically no difference, but maximum evidence and maximum use is enoxaparin. So if possible, stay with enoxaparin because it's the older one. It has maximum trials have used that, but there has been no difference as far as APS is concerned between them. The difference between them, again, from a medicine perspective, is more in cardiology again, where in cardiac patients, there has been a better of enoxaparin than deltaparin, but here there is no difference.
And I just add something here, you know, just to discuss what Samir was discussing about unfractionated heparin. The prophylactic dosages are 5,000 units in the first trimester twice a day, and in the second trimester onwards 10,000 units twice a day. So this is the basic suggestion for if you're using unfractionated heparin. About the use of type of heparins, it has been said that the lower the molecular weight, the better it is as such. So therefore, enoxaparin is a natural candidate as such. But the other drug which is used is bemiparin, which is also equally good. Unfortunately, not available. It has a very high anti-10A to anti-2A ratio, which is a determinant as such. And this is something which is important. But the most tested, the single molecular weight heparin is enoxaparin. Yes.
Yes.
Sir, can I ask you one question, Dr. Shinde?
Yes, sir.
I want to know when should we involve the other super specialists, like, you know, rheumatologists and we keep on treating them ourselves. Where should we draw a line and when we should involve multi-speciality in APS syndrome in pregnancy?
Yes, sir. So I think two straight away indications is any history of thrombosis, because there the patient will require evaluation and monitoring lifelong. So the patient should ideally be on treatment before the pregnancy itself. So if the patient has a past history of clot any point of time, MI, stroke, DVT, pulmonary embolism, ulcers can also be a manifestation of vasculopathy. So anything like that, any systemic history in the past, the patient should get evaluated even before conception. And that's the one place to refer either to a rheumatologist or to a hematologist. Both can do that. Second would be a patient having features of SLE, which means patient having arthritis, rash, oral ulcers, alopecia, renal involvement, pleural effusions. In India, I would, in fact, this is off the chart, I might add, a lot of patients of SLE don't know they have SLE. They, in fact, were told at some time they were having recurrent fever. Someone told them typhoid, someone told them TB, but they have been having recurrent fevers for last few months. And they might just give you that much history ki recurrent fever hota hai. They might have nothing else, but that's a marker of inflammation. So if that is one more indication I might add. It's not in the guidelines, but something we see commonly. Recurrent fevers with other systemic features, these would be the indications to refer. Apart from that, only obstetric complaints. I don't think there is any role that we have to play in it, because finally it's going to be the same treatment from your that we would start and continue for the rest of the period. The time to refer such a patient would be after postpartum, because then I guess the patient might not be in your follow-up for longer period, and then managing the later part of warfarin or heparin, that again a physician or a hematologist would be required.
Would a medico-legal...
Sir, you're on mute, sorry.
Imperative, I mean, should we take this before starting low molecular weight heparins for a long time? We are going to give for almost 9 months.
I don't know that.
Medico-legally, why I'm asking is today is a medico-legal era. Should we take the risk and start? Like you said, it's not required. But what will be the medical...
What I usually follow, but again, I would say that most of the people here are senior to me on that. But I would put my two cents on this. I feel if there is a guideline issued by the obstetric associations, it is very much your topic. There is nothing that I would change in it. As long as whatever the guidelines have been issued by a particular society, the obstetric society has issued guidelines and has put in the monitoring. I'm not aware, I've not read about them, but if they are there, that is medico-legally safe, because it says that the obstetrician can do it, unless the guidelines have mentioned that you need to refer, which is unlikely.
Dr. Ashar, sir, Dr. Gopinath Chana always used to say in your textbook reference should have the guidelines. And I think the latest RIS has mentioned all these doses. Dr. Rajkumar, sir, the dose which you told the question in the chat box is for therapeutic or prophylactic, the unfractionated heparin?
Therapeutic.
So prophylactic will be only once a day, right?
Well, that has got to be seen. Okay. Because prophylactic.
And probably... can you just write that other drug which you said for the benefit of the audience? Like you said, man, some new drug which is not available in India.
Can I go?
Rivaroxaban?
So there is a question by Dr. Manohar Motwani, Dr. Sushant Shinde, sir. If there is a role of empirical use of aspirin and low molecular weight heparin in a patient of recurrent miscarriage with negative lab parameters of APLA and no other obvious cause?
Not from my perspective. I do not know if there is a separate indication in obstetric for it, but from a rheumatology perspective or medicine.
Sometimes our patient the social economic strata patients don't want to do all these tests because they are expensive. And then they have one or two abortions which are fitting the criteria. Then whether giving a treatment is easier.
From a medicine perspective, I would say there is no indication for it.
Well, Samir, I would just like to bring out a study which has been presented. In fact, Cochrane database also suggests that giving it blindly has no advantages. That study that has been quoted in the Cochrane database mentions very clearly that there are no advantages. There is no extra salvage rate giving it prophylactically in patients who are not tested. So therefore, it doesn't make any sense giving that.
Yeah. So that answers the question. Yeah, Dr. Saroge, sir.
I would like to congratulate Urmila for getting such a gem. Like Dr. Sushant Shinde, who clarified everything about APLA syndrome. Sir, I have a few questions.
Yes.
APLA syndrome is a condition which the body produces antibodies that targets phospholipids. Now, phospholipids are molecules which are present on cell membrane, including endothelium. Now, cell membranes are present all over the body. Why it targets only endothelium?
So it does not
target all the cells in the body.
So it does not target only endothelium. Perhaps it targets more than that. That is what we are seeing now. That the small vessel vasculopathy that we are talking about, or the small vessel disease that we are talking about, whether those antigens are really vessel antigens or is it also targeting neuronal tissue? That is right now under consideration. So it again, in case of obstetric also, it is targeting residual tissue. So it's not completely correct. That was our older understanding that it is targeting the endothelium. But now we think that's only a part of the story. There is more to it, which we are probably understanding. So neuronal tissue and renal tissue, and in case of obstetric, the placental tissue, the decidua, these are also targets now of antiphospholipid antibodies. So
in that case, sir, if it is targeting the blood vessels causing thrombosis, the end artery should be the first one to get affected, like renal artery, ophthalmic artery, like your toes. Blood supply to the toes. We hardly come across such cases of gangrene of the toes in such cases.
So we do see them, sir. Actually, I don't think we see them commonly because overall APS is not common. But when a patient comes to it, so if I think in terms of, so if I was to deliver this talk in a rheumatology circle, my primary concern or my primary case of APS would be someone coming with an infarct. A toe infarct, a renal infarct, a non-healing ulcer. So those are our presentations when we see from rheumatology perspective. So we do see it. Of course, they are not the commonest. But again, I don't have an answer why are they not common and why something else would be common. But again, DVT overall also is common. So probably because we are seeing a particular organ system. So if my denominator, I'm just thinking over here loudly, if my denominator of seeing so many DVT cases is there versus how many patients do I overall see of coming with peripheral infarcts, there are not many. But if I see a peripheral infarct within that small cohort, APS is definitely on the top of my list. It's not my last diagnosis there. It's second, third diagnosis. After I rule out endocarditis, I'm going to think of APS. But when I think of DVT, there are so many other causes also of DVT. There, APS would be lower down on my list. So, you know, I think it's not just a unifactor or unidimensional answer I can give why it's affecting or not affecting something. And being a rare condition, I think we'll have to just see that multiple affections. So there are very few diseases which can do what it does. Artery and venous clots, that is not something many conditions can do. Most of them have either arterial or venous. This is the one which has both.
Can it cause gynec problems like dysfunction uterine bleeding?
I don't know.
You only talk about obstetric problems.
Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I don't know about it.
Now, is it hereditary?
No, sir. It's not hereditary. In fact, this is something I would say about all rheumatic conditions. Most of the rheumatic conditions are, it's a big misconception. People feel it is hereditary. They are not. Most of them are not.
So it's always an acquired disease.
It is an acquired disease, but again, factors are not known, but it is an acquired disease.
So it's not likely to occur at a newborn baby or something like that.
So there have been reports of maternal antibody getting transferred and the child having complications in the first 20 weeks or so. But beyond that, it's a disease rare in children. Most of the patients would, as I've said, come at 35, but I would expect adults 20 and above only to start presenting with it, not in children.
What is the incidence worldwide and in India?
Worldwide, I think it's debated, but it is said that it could be 0.5 per, I forgot the per that it had mentioned. I read it, but I'm sorry, I don't remember the numbers. In India, I'm not aware, I have not read, but I read about the world, and I'm sorry, I can't quote it. But it was 0.5 per, I think, 1 lakh or something. It was a rare thing that they described.
If patient is already on aspirin for XYZ reason, she is less likely to get a problem, particularly thrombosis.
I don't think we can say that because I'm thinking in terms of this, that if this was to be true, we would not have got the second thrombosis. Most of the patients who have the first thrombus in form of stroke or MI, they would be on aspirin for the rest of their life and they would develop it despite it. And that's when we think, okay, maybe just aspirin is not sufficient. Let's add an anticoagulant as well. So I don't think just aspirin has that much of it to completely prevent it. Otherwise, we would not have seen the second thrombus coming up. And anyways, for a first thrombus, we don't even evaluate for APS. So if I get a patient having just DVT or just MI, I don't always think of APS as a possibility. It's the second time that we start evaluating the patient. So going by that, I think aspirin does not really completely prevent it alone.
Can apply an ITP coexist, immune thrombocytopenic perfusion?
Yeah, absolutely. They can coexist. And when they coexist, my diagnosis is most likely SLE. It is under the umbrella of SLE that they are going to coexist. And there,
arthritis and APLA coexist.
Yes, sir. Of course. So arthritis, either rheumatoid or SLE causing arthritis and APS can coexist. SLE can have many other diseases, including ITP. And those will be the cases where we are justified in giving immunosuppression.
How do we differentiate it with the Hughes syndrome, sticky blood syndrome?
I don't know, sir.
What is the life expectancy of APLA syndrome patient?
I don't think it's changed. It is the same as it would be for anybody else. Unless the patient develops a vital organ involvement, the overall population expectancy has not come down significantly.
Why butterfly rash occurs in SLE?
I don't know, sir.
What is LAC blood test? Can we do it on the bedside?
The lupus anticoagulant?
Lupus anticoagulant test, if patient's blood contain apply antibodies, it will bind to phospholipid in a test tube and the blood will not clot or it will get prolonged. Or that means APTT, roughly you have an idea.
It is going to be prolonged. So there is one additional step we do in that. So when we do the lupus anticoagulant test, what we are trying to find is the test when we do it, we are doing this, we are doing what you just now said. We take the blood, we see whether it is clotting. It does not clot. Then what we do is we add the plasma, pooled plasma from a normal person, thinking that if this person does not have the coagulation factors, if I give him the coagulation factor, the blood should clot. Now, when I give the coagulation factor, still the blood does not clot, which tells me there is an inhibitor of coagulation which is there, which is the lupus anticoagulant. So it's kind of a double test that we do. We first do the test, see whether it is clotting. It is not clotting, so we give the normal plasma. It still does not clot, so we deduce that, okay, there is someone inhibiting that coagulation process.
So while you are at this test, can you just tell us, is there any precaution to collect the blood? Because that is what I had heard sometime. And the test has to be done within a certain period of time. Otherwise, if it kept for a long time, the platelets get activated and they cause some problems in this testing.
So,
and what is LA1 and LA2 and the ratio? That some other laboratories give this ratio.
So I'm not aware of the LA1 and LA2 ratio, sir. But about the test, the only precaution that we advise is the patient should not be on any drugs which are interfering, especially anticoagulation. Second is it should be collected in, the sample should be collected and processed as early as possible. Again, in the settings that we are in, we would say
that citrate bulb, right?
In a citrate bulb. In a citrate bulb. And the third thing is we do it by two techniques. We do by testing the APTT and the diluted Russell Viper venom test. Both of these can be done. Any one of these could also be done. So I don't know whether that LA1 and LA2 is that. I'm not sure what that means.
Yeah.
But both of these are techniques to test for anticoagulation. And then we have to add the normal plasma, a normal plasma, to see whether it is coagulating or not.
Sushant, can I ask?
Yeah, Mukesh, go ahead. I have plenty of questions. So you can...
No, just the question was related to this SLE, the ANA positive. So, can you throw some light on Rolla test and the congenital heart block? Because we have had such a case and their immunoglobulin was given and the child survived. And then after the birth, we had to put a pacemaker.
Anti-Ro and anti-La.
Yeah, sir. And just continue on the same question. When does one do the ANA blot? Because that gives all these things.
Yeah. So, there are two things. One is... if the patient was already a known case of either SLE or Sjogren syndrome, it is less likely to be Sjogren because Sjogren very often comes to us after the age of 40, but is much more likely to be SLE. But these two patients, SLE and Sjogren, they can have variety of antibodies positive, especially SLE. Now, in SLE, what I expect to see is an ANA positivity. ANA negative SLE is almost a diagnosis I will not make. There can be around 2% cases that way, but I would stay away from making that diagnosis. So if it is ANA positive, then we ask for an ANA blot assay. If the ANA is negative, doing an ANA blot assay does not carry any additional value. So that's why I said, if your ANA is positive, then you do anti-DSD. Now, just like anti-DSDNA is one of the extractable nuclear antigen, it's one of the components of the nucleus. Similarly, Rho, La, Histone, then others that we have, U1RMP, SM, all these are components of the nucleus which can come out positive. Based on that, we get a judgment based on that and the clinical features, whether the patient is at risk of other things. So for example, if I have a case of SLE, and she's anti-DSDNA positive, I know that her risk of nephritis is higher, her risk of vasculitis is higher. Similarly, if I have a patient of SLE, ANA is positive, Rho and La are positive, or any one of them is positive, her risk of having Sicca syndrome, that is dryness of eyes and mouth, that is higher. And if she is positive at the time of pregnancy for Rho and La, because they can become negative later also. So if you treat them early on, you might see Rho and La becoming negative as well. So if she was at the time of pregnancy positive for it, then there is a risk that the child can have congenital heart block. Now, if the child has congenital heart block, only then we need to step up the therapy. So there is no prophylactic therapy that I would give. So I wouldn't change her treatment. The treatment will be decided based on her other SLE parameters. Very often we do not stop steroids in a patient of SLE during pregnancy if she was on steroids at the time of conception. We advise patients to not conceive when the disease is active, but if the disease is active and she ends up conceiving, wants to go ahead, and there is no absolute contraindication, I will continue hydroxychloroquine, I'll continue steroids and whatever else if she requires, like azathioprine. If she develops, if while monitoring you realize that a child has a risk of developing congenital heart block, then IVIG has a role. Plasmapheresis, we are a little skeptical during pregnancy, but IVIG has a role that can be given at the time when that is diagnosed. But again, as sir has said, it is not a common thing, it's a rare thing. But if it happens, this is what needs to be done. And the child would require a pacemaker after delivery.
Sir, can I go now? Can one with APLA donate blood? Because plasma contains antiphospholipid antibodies. I can understand he can donate RBCs, he can donate platelets, but not the plasma, no?
So my answer is no, but again, I should admit, I've not read this somewhere, they cannot donate blood, but my understanding is no, they cannot donate blood.
Now, many a times patient comes to us asking about blood thinners in natural food, like turmeric, ginger, garlic, grape seeds, vitamin E. Are they really useful?
I don't know, sir.
Similarly, foods to be avoided with APLA, vitamin K rich food like avocado, broccoli, cabbage, beans, etc.
So those are if we are giving warfarin. So if we are giving vitamin K antagonist, which we wouldn't give during pregnancy, but if you are otherwise giving someone warfarin, then these foods are to be avoided. Otherwise, in a general, they are not changing anything about APLA. They are changing the efficacy of our drug if we are going to use warfarin.
Now, with all patients with APLA who get RPL, is it dependent on mild, moderate, severe form of APLA? You mentioned about the titers. If the titers are very, you talked about if all three are present, then it's a bad prognosis. But suppose one of them is present, forget about lupus anticoagulant. If one of them is present, now does it become mild, moderate, severe, depending on the titer?
No, sir. So positivity is positivity. If it is positive and I have confirmed it at 2 times, my outcomes are not going to change.
The problem is about confirming at 2 times at 12 weeks interval. By the time patient will abort also.
No, so we should ideally do it before the conception. So ideally this patient, so when do I evaluate? I evaluate when past history has been of a poor pregnancy. So before conception is when I should ideally do it. Now, if it has been done after conception, then we'll have to tell the patient that there is a limitation that you have already conceived. I don't have that much time. And then maybe, you know, I'm not sure if how medically we'll stand on this, but I would say it's okay perhaps to start aspirin if we have a doubt and a reason on just one test, I might start aspirin. But without that test, answer is no. At least one test should be done if there is pregnancy before you want to start the drug. And then preferably repeat the test. But if you end up giving heparin in between, then you can't even repeat that test. We'll have to then continue it empirically throughout.
Should aspirin be continued in third trimester because it can block or cause premature closure of ductus arteriosus?
From our side, the answer is yes. I don't know if that incidence is very high. The answer is yes.
Aspirin does not cause premature closure. NSAID is caused and aspirin is not considered
ibuprofen.
All NSAIDs will be responsible for premature closure, but the dose that is given, 75 to 150, does not cause anything. In fact, now they go to the extent of saying that even up to 150 milligrams, a spinal anesthesia can be given because of its minimal action on the platelets as such. So these are certain new things which are coming up, but of course this is debatable and has to be taken in context of whatever the presenting findings as such.
Shushan, do males also get APLA?
Sorry, sir.
Do males?
He said.
Men, yes, sir. Yeah, we can have male patients. But of course, they have thrombotic APLA and we do get patients. Okay. So we have lost some of them due to catastrophic APLA. So that's the dangerous form.
What is the role of IgA antibody in APLA antibodies?
No. So in practice, answer is no. We should not use it. In research, there is coming up evidence that IgA for anticardiolipin might have some role to play, but it is still in the research state. So in clinical practice, there are no recommendations to use IgA antibody. It's only IgG and IgM.
Can we switch over to warfarin in mid-trimester, second trimester of pregnancy instead of low molecular heparin?
We should avoid is what they are saying. You preferably continue low molecular heparin as much as possible. So preferably avoid switching over to warfarin. Sorry, sir.
Collect the blood for applying test tubes.
So if you are sending for these antibodies, then correct in the citrate pulp.
Citrate blood.
So a few things which I'd like to add here is that it is suggested that the blood should be collected in vacutainers and there should be no transportation. Most of the times patients are referred to a center which is a peripheral collection center, and from there the blood is shifted to the higher centers. So this kind of shifting is not allowed. The blood has to be sent to the parent center where the testing is done, where the blood sample is centrifuged immediately and the plasma extracted. So these precautions taken, then probably transfer is allowed. But the most important thing is that most of us refer patients to just writing on the prescription. The patient goes to a peripheral collection center and from there the blood is sent. In such circumstances, you may not get a correct result.
Dr. Sushant, there are certain questions by Dr. Nagarkatti, sir. When should heparin be stopped if the patient is for delivery or cesarean section? And if the patient has bleeding, then should we stop heparin and then whether we should restart? Suppose patient is started on this heparin and she has an element of threatened abortion or antepartum hemorrhage. What should be the line of treatment? We should stop aspirin or heparin or what?
So aspirin, I believe, doesn't need to be stopped. Heparin can be stopped maybe for 5 days to a week, and then it should be restarted. Once whatever is the reason that it was for stopping, if that reason has been tided over, it should be restarted. Because otherwise, we have to remember, even if this patient is bleeding, she remains in a procoagulant state. So she has that problem of having bleeding on one side, and she might clot on some other area. So not more than 5 to 7 days, I would say we should stop. Continue heparin the moment the bleeding has stopped and she's otherwise fit, continue with heparin.
And how much time before delivery or cesarean section we should stop? 12 hours?
That I'm not really sure of. So I'm not sure.
Add to what Sushant was saying, that there is a study which has been published in the RBM online 2017 from Israel, where they have assessed stopping of aspirin and low molecular heparin. And what they found was in patients of threatened abortion, it should be stopped if at all aspirin is being given as such. But in patients of APLA who are already on aspirin and low molecular heparin, if you continue that, the chances of live birth rate are more as compared to those in which you stopped.
So continue right?
Yes.
Not to stop anything.
Yeah. Yes.
That's if you do not have a contraindication. So if the patient has bled, then your question was about bleeding, then you have to stop.
This is patients who have bled in the first trimester because of threatened.
So similarly, there's a question in the chat box. If, as you said, after starting heparin, after 2 weeks, we have to repeat a CBC. And suppose that shows heparin induced thrombocytopenia, what do we do? Do we stop the heparin and only continue aspirin?
I would say refer to a hematologist. It's a rare complication and she might end up with new clots in the next few days. So if HIT is a dangerous one.
And similarly, there are questions about management of complications of heparin treatment. So I think low molecular weight heparin has no complications, but the unfriended heparin has osteoporosis as a complication. Mainly.
Even low molecular weight has it. So both heparins can cause osteoporosis as their complication. So that is why we would say that postpartum, shift over to warfarin if the patient still has an indication. But again, now they are saying 6 to 8 weeks ke baad hi shift karo. But osteoporosis can happen with both of them.
And there is another question which is trying to extrapolate that ANA positivity of SLE, whether a RA factor positive in a rheumatoid arthritis also leads to prothrombotic state, which is where the way to start all this aspirin and heparin.
No, so rheumatoid factor association with APS is much, rheumatoid arthritis association with APS is much weaker compared to SLE association. It's possible, but then we'll have to consider that patient has some component of SLE also. Very often there are overlaps between SLE and RA. So maybe the patient has a component of SLE also. But if I have no other thing to believe that the patient has SLE, if the patient had only arthritis and rheumatoid factor positive, ANA negative, and then APS positive, treat it like APS. We call it secondary, but you treat it like APS. And if RF is positive, but APA antiphospholipid negative, ANA negative, then there is no obstetric concern at all. You don't need to start anything. HCQS, if the rheumatologist continues, you continue. But otherwise, there is no reason to start from your end for that.
Dr. Rajkumar Shah, your questions in the this, you want to ask them?
I think they have already been answered. So, besides the standard indications for testing of APS, what are the under indications for testing for APS, which I think has been discussed? Would you suggest that these tests be done for pre-embryonic pregnancy loss. Usually what is said is, you know, there's a pregnancy which comes up, fetal sounds develop, and then suddenly fetal sounds stop. So this is something which is typical of antiphospholipid antibodies. But is there any role where there is no heartbeat seen and the pregnancy becomes an becomes something like a miscarriage? So this is called as pre-embryonic, before 6 weeks of pregnancy. So
why even for chemical pregnancies we should think of?
Yes.
So I think
I think the latest hypothesis.
Sorry.
Continue, sir.
So I think as far as my knowledge goes, that should fit into the first criteria. It's before the 10th week. So I think it should fit into the first criteria, and then we'll have to count three. So ideally.
The lupus anticoagulant is a missing.
I think the criteria is that the fetal pole has to be seen. Otherwise, it's more in goes in favor of genetic factors. And in the criteria, it is also mentioned that there is no genetic problem. Like in the revised SOPORO criteria, they have mentioned the fetal losses where there is no other genetic or chromosomal problems. So that is also mentioned. Sir, I had one. There are a few questions about infertility. Like Dr. Rajkumar Shah mentioned that there is no role of empirical ecosprin or low molecular weight heparin. Dr. Motwani sir has asked how it is then. I think that question is cannot be related to Dr. Sushant Shinde. He has asked that a lot of IVF specialists now give ecosprin and low molecular weight heparin throughout the IVF cycle. So how it is then allowed? That I don't think it is. Can be given this question can be asked to Dr. Sushant Shinde, sir. Sir, I have one question. Cases of infertility or irregular menses with subclinical hypothyroidism, we sometimes do antithyroglobulin antibody and antimicrosomal antibodies and they are positive. So, and these patients are keen on conception. So, in such cases, do we do their ANA, ACL or LAC prior to conception?
So,
because there is a correlation ACL between those and autoantibodies.
Yeah, so ACL, that is any antiphospholipid antibody, no role just because the patient is hypothyroid, not indicated to test. ANA, only if the patient has other features in form of arthritis, alopecia or anything of that sort, because we should remember ANA can be falsely positive in a lot of hypothyroid patients. Just the way they have developed an anti-TPO antibody, they might develop an anti-nuclear antibody also. In fact, that's one of the common reasons we see falsely positive ANA in our practice. So I would say unless the patient has a clinical requirement to test for SLE or any form of autoimmune disease apart from thyroid, don't test ANA also. I don't think it changes anything in the obstetric parameter as far as what my knowledge goes. And definitely no reason for testing for APS. APL.
And from your talk, we came to know that catastrophic APLA has a very high mortality, almost 50%. Suppose we are treating a case of ANA positive case and APLA positive in our nursing home. Do you suggest that we, how do we diagnose such complications beforehand? Or we tell these patients and we manage them in a tertiary care as a preventive, as an abundant caution?
Yeah, so that's a very relevant question, I would say, for the kind of practice we have in Bombay. I think if the patient during pregnancy develop, who is a known case of APS and we are following up an APS case, or I would even go one step further and say that maybe she is not having APS diagnosed, but ANA was positive. That means SLE is there, or at least a possibility of SLE is there. If the patient develops a single episode of clot, I would say we should ideally have this patient hospitalized and in a tertiary care center, for a simple reason that catastrophic APS would not be known till it occurs. And that will occur over the next 2 weeks. We don't have that leisure or way to figure out ye hone wala hai ki nahi. But if it happens, then she's going to require things like IVIG and plasmapheresis. Access of that is not there in most of the nursing home levels. We might not get it. So it's better that such a patient is in the tertiary care center where plasmapheresis is immediately available, and if required, IVIG can be procured. So I would say, yes, if the patient develops clot, one, we step over to higher dose as low molecular heparin. Second, we shift her because that would be a high-risk patient.
So can I ask you one question more?
I have some more questions from the audience. They have been sent on the email which was given to them. So this question is from Dr. Monica Takarikar. In a case of ANA positive patient with primary infertility, is it safe for patient to conceive? One. The second is, if yes, folic acid, aspirin and low molecular heparin is already on, is there any role of adding steroids? And the third is, if yes, please let us know the dose and the duration of treatment.
Okay, so three components of the question, sir. First is ANA positivity, is it safe to conceive? If, as I've said, SLE, if it's not just ANA, it's SLE with ANA as a part of it, and that has been stable for 6 months at least, then yes, patients can conceive, provided there is no target organ damage. And the two target organ damage I'm worried about is one, pulmonary hypertension, she might not make it through the pregnancy. Second is active lupus nephritis. So lupus nephritis treatments usually would go for 1.5 to 2 years before we declare them as stable. So in that case, 6 months will not be a good idea. Someone having just arthritis, rashes, it's okay. But lupus nephritis or pulmonary hypertension or even myocarditis, which is rare, not a good idea. So ANA is not a problem. SLE active is a problem. Second, if she's having SLE, that is why she's on hydroxychloroquine or any other drug. And then the decision to take steroids or not is not, should not be related to the obstetric complication. It should be related to the status of SLE. As I said, if she's
on steroids,
she continues on steroids. If she's not on steroids,
so no,
obstetric. Urmila, you're audible.
Hotspot, de betu.
Urmila, you're audible. You can just mute, please.
And sir, could you please repeat the third part of the question? The second was steroids. Third was?
Is there any role for steroids and what is the dosage and duration of treatment?
So again, steroids should not be for the obstetric reason. It should only be for the rheumatologic disease, whichever is required. And if she's on steroid, I would say 5 mg per day of prednisolone is what we'll usually continue for the pregnancy period.
Sir, is there any... can I ask a question? Does LA cause more first trimester problems and ACL causes third trimester complications like IUFDA and severe PIH? Is there any correlation between that?
There is a weak, but there is a correlation with that. As I said, the abortion rates, the earlier abortion rates are higher with LA and the later preeclampsia and PIH, those rates are higher with ACL. So yes, you are right. That is there, but it's not such a strong association to say that it will always happen that way. Our treatments do not change because of that. Overall, it is an association which has been shown.
So it is more of an inflammatory change or a thrombotic effect? The abortions or miscarriages or BOH is more because of thrombotic effect or a direct toxic effect upon the fetus?
Not the fetus, but on the placenta. The decidua is suffering from inflammation. And that is now what we believe is the reason for the abortion or lost pregnancy. If I can just show you this slide again, this summarizes. So this summarizes what are the causes of fetal loss. So inflammation is one of them. Decidual involvement is another one. Then thrombosis is another one. So we are not in a state to say which is happening in which stage or which is happening to a given patient. But this is what we know today are the total mechanisms. We used to think thrombosis is the only one, but now we don't see those clots. So we realize there are probably more. But again, not to an extent where our drugs are changing anything.
So do you say that heparin works at all levels? It is not only on thrombotic level, but also an anti-inflammatory?
No, probably heparin is only working as anti-thrombotic at this stage.
So how does it help in the complement activation and other inflammatory changes? Why does it prevent abortions for that?
So probably it's not preventing abortions because of that. We don't know how it is preventing abortions. We do know that it is bringing down the thrombotic part only. That is why despite therapy, we are still going to be successful in bringing down, maybe treating around 75-80% only. The remaining of them are still not going to be successful. Despite our treatment.
So how do you treat that inflammation? Does aspirin treat that?
No, aspirin is also, the dose of aspirin which is given is anti-thrombotic or anti-platelet role only. It's not a anti-inflammatory role. Anti-inflammatory, just to give an example, dose of aspirin, anti-inflammatory is 100 milligram per kg. And here we are giving 100 milligram per day. So we are giving like really a very small dose. At this dose, it is only acting as anti-platelet. We are not really at a stage where we are handling the inflammation. So none of the
there is no treatment for inflammatory changes as on
today. As of now, no. We are not treating the inflammation.
So we are just treating. thrombotic episodes of obstructive history.
And that's why the earlier theory was that we are dealing with thrombus. So we thought we are dealing with thrombus because that was the only thing which was working. But agar aisa tha, we should have seen the thrombus. We did not see the thrombus. So that's why now the newer theory is coming up that complement is activated and all of that. But to parallel with that, we have not seen that immunomodulators are changing anything. Even hydroxychloroquine is still debatable. We give it. But it's debatable whether hydroxychloroquine is really acting as an anti-inflammatory there and changing the outcomes. Or is it just association we have seen, but it's not really the cause of it. So we don't know about it.
Just to
the third part of the question was which steroid to give and whether it's mostly prednisolone. But if in the Sjögren's syndrome, I think we have to give dexamethasone, right? Because it has to cross the placenta.
For congenital heart block you're talking about?
Yeah. If suppose you have to give steroids with this treatment, SLE, one gives heparin, aspirin, and then steroids. So mostly it is prednisolone. But otherwise, if it's anti-Rho or anti-La, one has to give the dexamethasone because it has to cross the placenta, right?
Yes.
Yeah. In continuation of the HCQS, I would just like to add to what Sushant has said, that HCQS reduces antiphospholipid binding to the sensitiotrophoblast, so it has an effect on the placental growth as such. It reduces pregnancy loss from 81% to 19%. Addition of HCQS in refractory OAPS, there has been a 78% live birth rate, which has been mentioned. And it restores trophoblastic cell fusion and helps differentiation. So therefore, it has some kind of role. It is a very inert kind of drug and has been used plentifully in pregnancy as such. So therefore, there is some role of HCQS being used.
So when to start? Before, can start it in the first trimester itself, HCQS?
Yes. Now, another question by Dr. Anju Hazari. Diagnostic criteria is if high levels of APL antibodies detected, need to repeat after 12 weeks. How practical is this in terms of cost and impact on obstetric outcome? Sushant.
I don't know if I can answer that question about how practical it is, because cost analysis, again, it's a very subjective thing here. We don't have a formal cost analysis to my knowledge on this. But I feel it is imperative because the drugs we are going to use are harmful. So if you are going to give heparin, aspirin is still a low ticket. No, we perhaps might not cause any harm. But if you are going to give heparin to someone, I think it's worthwhile that we test it, because two reasons. One, the drug is having adverse effects. Second, if once I start using the drug, doing the test will become redundant. I can't do it. So I would rather say two things. One, test before the pregnancy. And second, as far as possible, do both the tests even during the pregnancy if possible. Maybe start aspirin and then wait and do the second test before you start heparin. I think it makes sense. About the outcomes, we have seen that.
Yes.
About the outcomes, so if a patient, diagnosis, it changes the outcomes. Sorry, sir. Go ahead, please.
So if a patient with 3 abortions presents to you with a pregnancy who has not been tested in the first trimester, probably you would go ahead with antiphospholipid syndrome testing as such, and maybe prophylactically start her on low dose aspirin and wait for the results to come. If the result is positive, then with the history of previous 3 losses and 1 test being positive, I think there is reason enough to start low molecular heparin. Your response on this?
I think, sir, heparin, I would wait. I can start aspirin. I would wait for the 12-week period to start heparin, because the toxicity, the adverse effect profile does exist. If the patient develops an adverse effect, then we will find it very difficult to justify how did we justify giving heparin without having an APS diagnosis in place. The stake goes up. If I'm using aspirin, my stake is low. I don't expect the patient to have any major bleeding anywhere. But with heparin, I can't really see that. So I would not feel comfortable doing that.
In lupus anticoagulant, we are measuring the activated partial thromboplastin time. Now, we are seeing the prolongation of the activated partial thromboplastin time, and this is an anticoagulant. So how do we say we are seeing the prolongation of the time, and this is an anticoagulant? So how do we say that these two things correlate?
Sir, madam, sorry, we see a prolongation which is not corrected by adding plasma. So what we have done is we have seen that the patient's blood is not getting clotted. And after it is not getting clotted, we are adding coagulation factors. And despite that, it is not getting clotted. But so we believe that the patient has something in her blood which is preventing that coagulation from happening.
But it is a thrombotic status. When we say that antiphospholipid syndrome is a thrombotic status, and we are giving importance to an anticoagulant, that increase in the anticoagulant.
So, that is because the action is not direct. So if I can just go back to the slide, I got your question. If I can just go back to that slide, it should be clearer that what we are talking about is this step. We are dealing with the first hit. When we are testing for the antibody, right? But when we talk about the clot formation, the antibody is not the one which is forming the clot. The antibody is causing antibody complex with beta 2 glycoprotein and other such proteins, which are causing a damage to the neutrophils, which are causing a damage to the endothelium. This damage is where the clot formation is starting. So if there are two hits, and what we are testing is the antibody level. We are testing at the level of the first hit, and the clot formation is happening once you start damaging the endothelium. Once you damage the endothelium and you activate the coagulation cascade, then clot thrombosis will start. So the lupus anticoagulant is just a marker. It's not the cause of the clot formation. It's a marker that the patient has something which is going to further bind with beta 2 glycoprotein, further further activate the coagulation cascade, and further also damage the endothelium and cause inflammation there. So these two pathways will come after that.
Thank you. And does pregnancy testing the antiphospholipid APTT, does pregnancy affect this test? Because pregnancy is a thrombotic status.
I don't think so.
And so the question is more relevant for the congenital thrombophilias, where in pregnancy we cannot do the protein C, protein S, yes, and antithrombin 3 deficiency, which are also causes of recurrent miscarriage.
But I don't think the testing for APS changes in that parameter.
So in which cases should we do the anti beta 2 glycoprotein 1, because we don't do it routinely?
I think take home message is we should do it in everyone.
Yes.
I should accept this, that a lot of patients who do come to us, that's the only test which is remaining for me to do. Everything else has been done before the patient comes to me. But I think it should be done in all, because now we know that's the most specific test. Though it doesn't have the worst outcome necessarily, but it is the most specific test, and all the other tests are also somewhere related to the molecule beta 2 glycoprotein. So we should test for it.
So, and there's one question by Dr. Aditi. In a severe renal disease with stage 4 or 5 in SLE, is it an indication to terminate pregnancy?
So,
or we can give steroids, high dose, and we can give IVIG and try to continue.
I think it will be a very difficult answer to give, because it will depend on parameters. Let me just answer this as simply as I can. When I think of SLE, I see SLE in two parts. I see a patient of SLE lupus nephritis having active lupus nephritis. At that time, I will say, yes, the chances that the mother will suffer grave consequences is high, and the chances that the pregnancy will also not reach the end is high. I would rather go with abortion if she is having active lupus nephritis. The good part is most people don't conceive at that part, because there are many other things going on. She will have serositis, arthritis, many other things. Her general health is really bad at that time. And that time she's on high doses of steroids. Probably she's missing periods and menses. The reproductive health is also affected at that period. We don't see this happening most likely. And that is the stage where I will say, yes, probably medical termination does make sense. The question will come when we talk about CKD, that is the later stage, when the inflammation has gone away and the scarring has been left into the kidneys. And at that time, really, there is not much role of giving strong steroids or something, because the inflammation stage is gone. You have left with a sclerosed kidney, a shrunken kidney. Then I would say it is more to do with what is her renal parameter. Is her blood pressure controlled? Is her urine output fine? Is she having a creatinine clearance of more than 30, where you can use most of the drugs? If all of these parameters are fine and she understands the risk, my understanding of nephrology, now I'm crossing over there, is it can be continued. There is no absolute reason to terminate the pregnancy if everything else is stable. But that would happen from the first stage to the second stage, with or without treatment, will take around 1.5 to 2 years. So if she was diagnosed SLE, let's say 3 months back, then not a good idea to continue with pregnancy. Lupus nephritis 3 months back, 6 months back, not a good idea to conceive at this time.
I'd like to share one experience of mine. I had a patient which I joined, referred to me by a nephrologist, who was a post-renal transplant. Renal transplant was done for lupus nephritis. And throughout her pregnancy, I managed her in the nursing home, but I told her always that the delivery will be in a higher setup. So we had to give a labetalol for her hypertension from beginning, a higher dose. She was on HCQS and azathioprine, also levamisole as a to prevent a rejection of the graft. And then also I involved the rheumatologist. Then she had gestational diabetes because of the high dose of steroids, which we had to give insulin. And then ultimately we pulled on till 32-34 weeks. And then she had a severe preeclampsia. So all that has to be told to the patient in the beginning, all this thing can come. And but luckily now she has a baby. That is the thing.
Right.
Any more questions? I think I think all the questions are answered from the chat box also. And a fantastic talk, sir. Right from the basics to all our queries have been answered. And
Samir, I have one question.
Yes, sir.
I want to know whether there is any rationale of using aspirin, because of whatever in between there was a big trend to use aspirin 75 milligram for each and every damn patient who comes with the pregnancy in the clinic. And 75 milligram was started, which boosted the sale of aspirin to the tune of crores in the international market.
Yeah, sir, similar question I asked in a hypertensive panel workshop, because nowadays to diagnose a risk of hypertension, they are doing all this PGLF and S-split ratio, which are very expensive. But then the consensus and the Cochrane, all these things say that aspirin cannot be used empirically, because there is a risk of whatever, even when the low dose has a risk of GI bleed or other things. So only if it is diagnosed any disease or any high risk for preeclampsia by this extended fetal first trimester screening, only then it has to be used.
Yes,
and the dose now for that is over 75, they say, but the aspirin dose is 150.
No, Samir, what I am saying is that I wanted to know from Shinde, because this is what is, we are still seeing some prescriptions, you see, that the aspirin is prescribed. When I ask the patient, you have any issue, then he say, no, I have no problem. And we checked everything, you still find the patient is told to take aspirin. That is why I want to know whether there is any rationale or it can be a big issue later on, because this big study which was conducted has ultimately proved it was that the results were leaked in between, and at the end it was proved that it was not necessary except for one or two definite indications. Anyway, I think what you said is also right. It is not to be given as a routine. That is what I want to send the message. That's all.
I think Ujwala can take over for the closing remarks.
On behalf of AFG, I would like to thank Dr. Sushant Shinde for such a wonderful presentation. Also, I would like to thank all the chairperson, delegates, and faculty, and our academic partners, Sun Pharma, makers of Sustain and Sustain SR, also Zuventus, makers of Zubistan. So we end the CME on here.
We also thank SV. And special thanks to Dr. Sushant for spending your Sunday with us. Dr. Saraogi sir, to be there to ask so many questions and prepare so many questions. Dr. Samir Pradhan to spend his time with us. Dr. Mahesh Asher to be there with us. Thank you, Sushant, thank you for your wonderful talk.
Thank you for the opportunity, ma'am. And I would like to thank everyone. And I hope I could answer some of the questions at least.
All of them.
You answered all the questions, sir.
And very reliably and very knowledgeably. So I think really good. Hats off to you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.